questions. We'll after each session, I'll introduce the sessions to you. After, like I have broken it down to three parts. After each part, you can have questions, and we will spend at least 5 minutes on question answer. If you have any immediate questions, you can note down and you can put it there. You can directly send it to Dr. Ajit Pradhan. He's there. I have told him about it. So you can send it to him or you can put it on the chat box and then somebody will pick it and I'll be able to answer a few questions. And at the end, if you have time, then I'll be able to respond. If we don't get time, don't get disappointed because I'll be there on Facebook and on email. You can always contact me and you can share your questions and I'll be able to respond. Would love to actually be involved in the kind of assessment you are doing, online assessment I'm talking about. If you have any queries and questions related to how to do something, if you are in a kind of doing something and you need some advice or you need some help or support, or you think that you need somebody else's point of view or somebody else thinks about your assessment, maybe you can let me know and I can think about what you are doing, whether I'll be able to help you in some way. So let's begin. I'll share my screen. Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So here is my plan. What I plan to do today. Just give me 1 second. Okay, so I will start with a framework for employing digital assessment and digital tools for language assessment of language skills and competence. So that is the first thing I'll be talking about. I need to create a framework so that you understand what I'm talking about and where I'm placing in this entire session. Because there might be more than one perspective to digital assessment. So I want to make my position clear in this framework. And this framework, though I'll not be using any academic research, I won't be citing any academic research, but it's based on academic research evidence and empirical proof. If you are interested, you can talk to me and I can respond to that later about research on these things, because what I'm going to talk about will be based on research, but I won't be citing research and doing things explicitly because there might be teachers who may not be interested in research part. So this is not a research presentation as such. This is more of a pedagogic presentation, and correct me if I'm wrong. If you need any research related information, then we can have a different conversation on Facebook or elsewhere. The second thing I'll be talking about will be how we can find, select, and use digital tools. Finding is not the biggest thing, as Ma'am was talking about, the Vice Chancellor, that it's more or less we are aware of things and it's more about bringing them together. This is what we'll be talking about. So finding may not be an issue. Selecting and using will be two important things that we'll be doing in this session. I'll try to make it as hands-on or as demonstrative as possible, but sometimes I might be lecturing a bit because we have only certain amount of time. So I can't do it with everybody on computer and doing it. I'm monitoring that kind of thing is not going to happen because that will be more of a workshop. So this will be more of try to be interactive, but can't guarantee how much I can be interactive in this. Let's see. And the next one will be how we can keep track of the impact. This is very important. This is generally in most presentations where we talk about it, how to use technical tools, technological tools, digital tools, and we leave it there. I think that will be kind of slightly skewed, a skewed approach to using digital tools, because you need to find trace the impact. Unless you know how it's useful, whether it's helping you and how it's helping you, there is no point in using them. Why would you spend so much time, energy, learn things and do everything and not be able to help your learners and save your time? These are the two things I have in mind all the time when I'm thinking about as a digital assessment. I'm thinking about how to save time for myself or people who I'm talking to, and how to make assessment more effective, how to make learning more effective. Because the kind of assessment we are talking about is not standardized in nature. So it'll be more of learning-oriented assessment or classroom-based assessment, or it's called formative assessment, teacher-based assessment. You can have alternative assessment, dynamic assessment. You can bring in a lot of terms. So those kind of things, not really standardized as such. And then we'll have a question answer, but I'm placing question answer after each subsection that I have here, three subsections. So after each subsection, I'll get back to you and ask you if you have any questions. And then I'll get back to Dr. Ajit and I'll ask him if he has collected a few questions, and if he shares some questions, then I'll be able to respond. Okay, so let's get started. So here is the framework that I'm talking about. You can see the framework. This is entirely what I have found in research. This is not copied framework. I have designed it, not taken from anybody. This is nobody's framework. This is my own framework as such. But this is just to make you understand what I'm trying to do here. And this is entirely based on empirical research. This has been proved. Things that have been proved, I have taken them, put them together, simplified them and put them together to make you understand how you can approach digital assessment. First thing is we start with, when we talk about digital assessment, we are starting with teacher's ability. By teacher's ability, I'm talking about two things related to teacher's ability. Teacher's ability to assess, teacher's ability to deal with digital tools. So if you look at terminology, you have two terms, you can find two terms related to these two kinds of practices. The first one is assessment literacy, which has to do with the knowledge and skill you need to be able to carry out assessment in your context. That also takes into account some amount of, you have awareness about the context in which you are working. You have awareness about your learners. You have awareness about the resources you have, the time you have, the support you have, and many other things which are context oriented. Those, you are aware of those things. You know those things really well. The next part is digital literacies. I deliberately kept it plural because literacy is kind of slightly narrow. I'm keeping it broad. I'm talking about different kinds of literacies which come under digital literacies. It's not only digital tools. It goes beyond digital tools and includes several other kinds of literacies. So I include here media literacy, some educational literacy, context literacy, different kinds of literacies we're talking about. So here, more or less, we broadly, if you want to define, it can be defined as knowledge and skills required to use digital tools. That also includes your knowledge about or your awareness about what your students are doing, what kind of digital tools they're using. The kind of digital tools you have access to, which are free, which are not free, how to work on them, which are the tools which are new, which have been established, which have been proved good, some research in the area, something that is useful for your classroom. So all those things put together can be called digital literacies. So when I'm talking about teacher's ability, I'm talking about these two things put together, assessment literacy and digital literacies. This is precisely what ma'am was talking about, Dr. Naik earlier. She was talking about these two things, how to bring them together. This is exactly what I am talking about here, how to bring them together. The next thing I have in mind is practice. Once you have these two things, you need to practice. I'm talking about practice of digital assessment. The first thing that you need to do is to identify language skills or sub skills that you want to assess. So let's say you are assessing speaking. In speaking, what you say that maybe interaction among whom. Say that teacher student, okay, how long? Then you say that, okay, 1 to 2 minutes. So you are identifying what kind of context outside the classroom, in the classroom, what kind of topic, academic topics. So these are the things you need to, note down. You need to know very clearly. So identifying some language skills, I'm talking about what exactly in language skills you're talking about. And then the next thing is selecting the best methods of assessment. I'm talking about best methods of assessment. There is nothing called the best method, but you account several factors, several things like access to resources, knowledge about assessment, certain demands from the institution, your prescribed textbook, prescribed curriculum. So a lot of factors put together, you decide how best I can assess these skills or sub skills of my students. How many students are there, whether this kind of assessment is possible in this scenario or not, how much time I have, when I have to finish, whether I have resources. So all those things put together, you need to think about all those things together, and then you decide what method will be the best one for you in that particular situation. The next one is the digital part. So you see that we are talking more, when we're talking about digital assessment, we are talking heavily invested in learning more about assessment, knowing more about assessment than digital tools. It's somehow tilted towards knowing more about assessment. If you know assessment really well, then whatever tools you have, there will be difficulty. You need to learn all those things. And there I'm still talking about something people generally don't agree, but if you look at empirical literature, if you look at research literature, you will see that it's driven by the entire thing is driven by knowledge and skills, knowledge of assessment and skills what you plan to assess. Okay, these are the two things put together. They determine to a great extent what kind of digital tools you will be using for your assessment purposes. So if you are driven by tools, a tools driven approach is generally considered to be ineffective, less effective, or let's say that it may not drive you the way you want, it may not drive the learning of your learners the way you visualize, the way you want. It may not help them as much because you are driven by tools. So you are interested more in, that's a fancy tool, that's a nice one, that's a good one. So that is driving your thing, and you are dragging it to your assessment. That doesn't work. You need to assess well, which is the tool that can help me assess well. This should be your thinking rather, not the other way around. This is a good tool, how I can use it. That may not work really, really well. This is what research has established almost conclusively. So the third part is evaluation, which has to do with once you take a tool and then assess, you have the necessary assessment skills and knowledge, and you know what skills and some skills you need to assess, then you carry out an assessment on a platform, then you need to find out whether your assessment is effective. That brings you back to the first question, which is, what is the objective of my assessment? So if you are teaching something in the classroom, your assessment should directly reflect the same thing. So how effectively it captures the objectives, how effectively it helps you assess the objectives or the learning outcomes. This is one. Two will be how effective the tool is, whether your students found it usable or useful or enjoyable or interesting, uninteresting, boring, whatever. So you need to find out both the things, impact on student learning and on kind of what perception they have about the tool. These both the things are important here. Okay. Once you know how the tool is working, whether it's helping your learners or not, two, whether you like it and your learners like it as a tool, and you think that it's doing the job well and it's interesting, it's nice. Okay, it's convenient, nice, and effective. Interesting. After that, the next step will be making changes. So So if you think that there are areas, because it's always a continuous process, assessment is a dynamic process in the sense that if you carry out an assessment, you need to revisit it. You need to go back and check what you have done, how you have done it. To do that, then you are in a position to decide, yeah, I have to do this, I have to change this little bit, change it there, change it there, change it a little bit. Okay. So if you do that, then you are on track. So you will improve your assessment literacy, your digital literacy, and the assessment you created. All the three things will keep improving, and this cycle will go on again. That's why I have given this, you know, this arrow touching from this cycle again going back. So this is a kind of continuous process. It's a cyclic process. So you go back and revisit the same thing and see how you can improve it further. This is a process. You need to take it. There is no other way. So now that you have an idea about what I'm talking about, I'll just one second. I'll give you a very, just give me one second. Let's share one more thing, which you should be able to. Okay, so here I go. Yeah, can you open your mobile phone or computer and go to menti.com, menti.com, and use the code 6307-8447. I'll put it there on the chat box. That's the code. And that's the site. You go there, 6307-8447. That's the code. Go to menti.com and respond to this question. I would rate my digital literacy as good because I defined digital literacy earlier, average. There is no shame. You can be honest because nobody will know who is writing what. I don't know who you are. I'm just looking at this screen. Okay, I'll give you just one more minute. Finish rating. Wow, this is a good, very good audience because most of you have pretty good digital literacy level. Yeah, that's really nice. So maybe this, direct this webinar in that direction, assuming that most of the people have good level of digital literacy. I'll go to the next question. Okay. This is the next one. M-dash, various relevant digital tools. If you are not at all familiar, this can be one of the first tools you can be familiar with because this is a nice tool. All of you can use this. Wow, we are getting it fast. So most of the people are familiar with digital tools, various relevant digital tools. some of almost half of us are not really familiar with most of the digital relevant digital tools, various digital tools. Okay, so this is about digital literacy. We'll go to the next part. I'm stopping this. I'm sorry. You can keep voting. I'll go to the next one. Just give me 1 second. Here we go, one more quiz for you. And the code is 64807623. I'll just put it there in the chat box. That's code. You can register your choice here. And dash of my students' digital practices. Fully aware what they do with on digital platforms and tools. Partially aware, not really aware. Not at all aware. All are fine, no issues. Okay, most of us are partially aware. That's not bad, that's good. Great, so we are getting quick replies right now. Perfect. So we'll go to the one, I have one more question. So most of you work very hard, work hard to improve your digital literacy. That's a very good thing. If you're doing it already, then you are on track. You don't need anyone. You are already an independent learner, quote unquote. This is what we're talking about. If you're independent, then you are on, you know what the kind of digital tools you need to learn about and what are the things you need to master. Okay, so I'll stop sharing this. Let's talk about now the assessment part. Give me 1 second, I'll be sharing this. This will give us a good idea about where we stand, what we are doing in terms of our practices. And it will help me also in some ways to understand what you're doing right now. Okay, here we go. Share the screen. I'll put it there in the chat box. Put it there in the chat box, 2585-6986. I am Dash in language assessment, formally trained, means you have a degree, you have a course in master's or in MPhil or PhD, formally trained. Even a PGDT, PGCP will be good. Partially trained, you don't have a formal course in language assessment. You don't have a formal course. You are kind of attended workshops, present. You have, I'm talking about workshop means 5-day, 7-day, 10-day workshops. then you are partially trained. Not really trained means no formal training as such, standalone here and there webinars. Never trained means no idea as such. Wow, that's a good number. Formally trained and partially trained, that's really good. If you don't have training, you can always register yourself for a PGCT and PGDT from eFlu. And they have a course in language assessment that will help you a lot. Okay, I'm talking about people who are in India. And if you have money and you are from abroad, some other country, maybe a good place, or if you have money, you are from India, then an excellent course could be Cambridge University offers an excellent course. So go to Cambridge Assessment and search for a course, Basic Principles for Assessment, and do that course. That will cost you around, I think, 60,000-70,000 rupees, maybe. Quite costly, but worth. Maybe a little more. I don't know how much exactly. You have to check and find out. But that's a pretty good course, very good course. Or you can also search for US Embassy, sponsors a lot of courses, which I did earlier in 2012. You can do the same course. That was perhaps the best assessment course I have ever done in my life. Better than my formal training in assessment. Okay, let's go to the next question. How familiar are you with concepts such as validity, reliability, authenticity, washback, and practicality and their applications? You can speak freely. Nobody knows who you are. So yeah, it'll be good to know where you stand. Also, if you don't know, this is something or not really familiar. This is one thing you can take a screenshot and keep it and go back and check. A book by Douglas Brown and Abhay Vikrama. They have a wonderful book on principles of assessment. Very simple book and fundamental book. You can buy that book and look at it. That'll make you more or less assessment literate if you take some help from outside and read that carefully. You will learn how assessment works. Basic things, very basic. I'm not saying it will make you an assessment expert or something, but very basic and pretty good. Okay. Quite familiar with all these, and you are on track, you are doing well. I'll stop that. I need to know, just give me 1 second. I have one more. This is perhaps the most important question I was telling you earlier, the same thing. I know really well how to evaluate, or I know a little bit about know how to evaluate the quality of my assessment. Don't really know. Okay. This will be interesting because this is where the problem comes. If we don't know how to go back and assess our own verify the kind of effectiveness of our own assessments, then it doesn't take us anywhere. It remains a problem. So it's important that we know how to evaluate, and we'll talk about this briefly in this webinar, how to do this. So, Okay, 56 people have responded. I'll go to the next question, one last. This will be the last one for now. I won't have anything more on Mentimeter right now. Let's go to the next questions. Do you create original assessments? This is my question, but I phrased it in this way, framed it in this way so that I get the answer from you. Do you create your own assessments? That mean you search for past on your own authentic passages, create your own questions, verify the questions, take it to a colleague, ask them to verify your questions, go to your students, ask them about the questions, and then use them, or you adapt it from different sources. Both are fine, but I'm just talking about both have, you can have your own purpose behind or your intention behind why you are being original or why you adapt. So I'm not saying one is inferior to the other. Okay. So I'll stop sharing. I'll go back to my slides. We'll talk about digital assessment in detail and how to create digital assessments. Okay. Thank you. Let's go back. Okay. So I was talking about this, and I wanted to know what kind of practices you are engaged in, what you are doing as part of your as part of digital assessment or assessment as such. This gives us a good idea about where you stand, and then I can pitch my this webinar accordingly. Okay, so when I'm talking about, just give me 1 second. Yeah, so let's talk about the preparation stage. When we talk about digital assessment, I'm giving you an example how I would prepare for an assessment which I plan to conduct online. What would I do in some case? You can always tell me or ask me questions later, and suggest also if there can be modifications in the chat box, you can suggest. There can be different ways of doing it. I'm just giving you one kind of a systematic approach to doing something, some creating digital assessment, but there can be more than one approach. I'm not saying that this is the only way you can design. I'm saying that this is one systematic approach. If you're already doing it, it's really good. This is one, or if you're doing it differently, you can also share later. So let's say if you are talking about listening to an academic lecture and take notes, this is kind of listening heavy kind of activity where there is a bit of writing involved, but this is more listening heavy kind of activity. The study skills, if you are assessing this, how do I do that? So if I have to do this, these are a few things I need to think about immediately when I'm designing the assessment. The first thing is I'm thinking about is whether there are clips available which will be suitable for my students. Okay, this is something that you start thinking when you are teaching your class. Okay, because we are thinking about listening to lectures and taking notes, we are more or less thinking about an academic lecture. Okay, when we are thinking about an academic lecture, we are thinking about different subjects. We are thinking about lectures in, let's say I'm an engineering student, it could be physics, chemistry, computer science, biology, could be anything. One of the engineering subjects we are thinking about. If you're teaching business English, I'm thinking about some management course, this, that, or economics, something like that I'm thinking about. If you're teaching literature, I'm thinking about literature classes, drama, poetry, something, one of these things. If you're teaching psychology, so you can take any lecture from any discipline, depending on the kind of students you have. If they're from one single discipline, you can go for a very specific discipline-oriented lecture clip. But if people are from different backgrounds, let's say from science, some from engineering, some from economics, some from business, so business management, so all kinds of people to put together, if there is a class, And you can think about a general academic lecture, for example, somebody talking about very undergraduate course. Let's say, for example, you can think about how brain works, something that most of people have done class 10, 9, they must have already studied something. So a lecture on that will be really, really useful. So this is one. Two, the kind of accent you need, whether your students have exposure to non-Indian accents. If you're from India, if you're from another country, maybe not from your country, accent, a clip in which the speaker uses accent of, well, it's a British or American or some other accent, non-native accent for your country. Then you need to think about whether you can use those kinds of clips or not. Those are questions that you need to ask, and then select, and then the length, how long it should be, what kind of topic, which level, difficulty level, language difficulty, conceptual difficulty. You need to make balance. Too much of conceptual difficulty will be problematic in a, when you are training them and listening to lecture and taking notes. So think about these things carefully, and I would do this. Then the next thing is, create the task. What kind of task is appropriate or activity is appropriate? You choose that. There you think about whether I can do it subjective or I need objective, testing, assessment of this. By subjective, I mean, listen to a lecture, they create notes and submit to you. Is this what you want? Or you say, no, I cannot do that because we have 500 students in the class. And we are doing it for all, so I cannot have subjective assessment of note taking. That's not possible. We cannot do that. We don't have that much of time. So we need it objective. So you need to frame questions accordingly. Then you say that I'm going top down or bottom up. That means whether I am going directly with starting with notes and starting with lectures and listening to notes and then teaching them different formats and then teaching them summarizing, then teaching them using symbols and all, then teaching them identifying main idea, or I'm teaching them starting with how to identify the main idea in a lecture, how to find all kinds of things that will make a complete lecture. Okay, so you can start with the lecture entirely. You can begin your class with that and ask them to make notes. Then go back to different formats, like, for example, Cornell method, mind mapping, then outline method, then charting method. So there are different kinds of methods of note taking. So you teach them first this thing, or you teach them notes and then go back to this and teach them the methods, and then tell them that some research has established in some way that Cornell is more effective than other methods. So why not use Cornell? And integrate other methods inside it. I mean, when you are using Cornell, you can use mind map in Cornell notes. You can do that. Or you can use a bit of charting, use a bit of tabular form. So all kinds of things you can do inside that. So you need to decide what you want, how you have taught. In the same way, you have to think about the assessment thing. And the last thing, then the last part is finding the tools. So here I'm thinking about Google Forms will be really, really good. I'm thinking about subjective, objective, both. Okay. Then I'm thinking about, maybe Docs. Why not Docs? Why only Forms? Maybe Docs will be good because they can post it, whatever they have done, or they can create it and share with me. That's it. No, then somebody said, no, that. Let's have it on VoiceThread. Why not? I need to engage my students in some amount of self and peer assessment, so I'll do it on VoiceThread. And somebody said, why not share on WhatsApp group and then comment on each other? That'll be really, really good. So it'll be good self and peer assessment, plus you will be able to assess because it's on the WhatsApp group. So you need to think about what works for you in your setting, what your students will be happy with, what they agree with, where you can stop them from plagiarizing, and a lot of other issues. So take into account all these factors and then decide which of these tools would be appropriate for you. Okay. Before, this is something that I would. Come on. I planning to demonstrate this? No, I'm going to demonstrate here. Just give me 1 second. Okay. I'll show you on this clip. I'll show you how I will do. I will design something with this kind of thing. Just give me 1 second.
Sorry, we have muted.
Okay, just give me 1 second. I'll show you how I have done this. Okay, share with you. I have done this, and this is the same exact same assessment that I'm sharing that I have done in my institution here for assessing students online. So this is kind of a realia kind of thing for you here. Okay, so what I did here, I gave them a, you know, I gave them a video clip here. Okay, video clip is here. Okay, and I gave them attached notes. I created a screenshot of notes here. I wanted to make it not really objective, but not really subjective. So I removed points from the notes. So I have removed the title here, as you can see. The heading one I have removed, heading two I have removed. And then heading 3.1 I have removed. So some heading, some places, some information I have removed from here. And when I play this clip, they need to listen to this clip and fill in the information. This is what I'm talking about when I'm talking about finding specific information. This is what I'm trying to do. More specific than global, you can have it in, to put together, you can bring them together and assess both the things. You can assess their ability to find specific information from a clip. Also, you can do, you can ask them to find global information from a clip. So the questions can vary and notes can demand both. So when you are talking about note taking, you can demand both. But I thought this, I didn't want to give them entire how to create notes directly. But I wanted to show them one example, but at the same time, I want to, you know, assess them in the same at the same time. So this is more of a learning oriented assessment, teaching them how to do this, okay, how to take notes, and at the same time learn testing their ability to identify specific information from an audio clip or video clip, whichever. So when they get it, they get this kind of thing. And when I'm going here, I'll just share with you when I click on sharing, students will get this screen. Okay, they get this thing. And then I play this from here.
Research and write a script. Then we break psychology. It argues that there are 5 stages of human needs that motivate our behavior. Abraham Maslow proposed it.
So I showed you earlier that, This is on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And so immediately when they start listening, they know that it's Maslow's hierarchy of needs. They can write in the title, hierarchy of needs by Maslow. And then heading one, there are different types of needs. So once they listen to this,
his theory in 1943, after studying what he called exemplary people, such as Albert Einstein or Eleanor Roosevelt. First, there are physiological needs, such as the need to breathe, eat, drink, or sleep. The moment we get enough of that and we...
So here it's talking...
First, there are physiological needs, such as the need... After studying what he called exemplary people, such as Albert Einstein or Eleanor Roosevelt. First, there are physiological needs.
So he came up with a set of needs here. So you can write that the basic basis of needs and then or the set of needs. And then he talks about all kinds of needs here. Okay. You can select these things which are more general in nature. You don't need technical expertise. So I selected this for students who are from different disciplines, engineering, sciences, biology, and then economics and all put together in a class. So that's why I selected a clip which is more general in nature than anything else. I'll go back. Give me 1 second. Somebody is please don't spam the chat folders. It'll be if you want to conduct a survey, you can do it. You can send it to all. You can request people who have organized this webinar. You can ask them to help you with that. But if you spam it here, people may not be able to respond. Okay. I'll just go back to that. Do you have any questions for me? I'll just take a quick look and then, if you have any questions and then get back to this thing. Any questions till now for me?
Yeah, Dr. Santosh, we have a few very generic questions.
Please go on.
Can you respond to it now or you can?
You can ask if we'll see if we have anything specific, otherwise we'll go back.
First is Krishna Raju has asked, how can we differentiate between assessment and evaluation?
Okay, any other question other than that?
Yeah, second one is also a little bit generic. Vinay Kumar has asked, how to assess reading skills of students?
Okay. The first one you have immediate answer in Brown and Abhay Vikrama's book will give you answers. But unless you are into research on language assessment, there is no point getting into these terms and get caught up in these terms. There's no point because it won't get you anything. It won't actually yield you anything really productive, really significant. So no point thinking about these things unless you are into language assessment and these terms have a lot to you. So think about things. Okay, this is a good question Pragya has asked. Yes, I'll be talking about self-assessment, but subjective questions also we'll talk about. These are good things. We'll talk about those things. Am I audible?
Yes.
Perfect. So I think, Ajit, these are all generic questions, so we'll take specific questions a little later. We'll go back to the presentation and then get back. I don't think there is that more or less generic questions. I agree.
I think somebody has raised the hand.
Okay.
Yeah. I think you can unmute and speak. Yes.
Yes.
Hello. Thank you, Dr. Santosh, for your nice and informative presentation. I was watching your YouTube listening when you provided the students with multiple choice. They are supposed to listen and they are supposed to pick the answer. I was wondering, since the paradigm of language assessment and testing moves toward from the testing-oriented culture to more learning-oriented assessment, what if instead of multiple choice, we provide our learners with kind of collaborative dialogue in which the students are working together, they are taking note, and finally they come up with the gist of listening? Because nowadays here and there, instead of benchmarks, standards, in here and there, especially because of the post COVID-19, because of the validity issues, all, let's say, experts insist on the assessment for learning or assessment as learning rather than assessment of learning. I would like to know your, let's say, ideas about as an expert. Thank you very much.
That's a wonderful question. Very provocative and very relevant question. Thank you for asking this question. I showed you or demonstrated one multiple choice question or very short answer type question or almost objective. It's kind of a subjective-objective almost coming together, that kind of question. So I showed that kind of question because I'm dealing with a batch of 500 students. So I may not have the opportunity to put them together in a work on, let's say, in a classroom situation. Yes, when I have 30 students or 40 students, yes, I can do that. But when I have 100 students, if I have a large size classroom and I have loads of students in my class, asking them to, work on one clip and come up with a gist is possible when you have a short in a small classroom, when you have a very large classroom and you are required to assess and give the numericals or grades to the authorities, to your management, then it becomes an issue. Otherwise, I do agree with you that learning-oriented assessment should be prioritized. Assessment should be encouraged. I will go back to the presentation. Okay, so here, that was a good question, yeah. Very, very nice, yeah. So we are thinking about classroom-based assessment. We are thinking about subjective, more learning-oriented, learner-oriented, learner-centric, learning-centric kind of assessment, alternative, dynamic kind of assessment. We are not really encouraging standardized kind of or objective or discrete point testing. We should avoid as much as we can, but sometimes it's difficult when you have loads of students and you don't know how to evaluate them, how to upload their grades or scores. It's very, very difficult. So I'll take a balanced position. I will not go to any extreme to push teachers to slog through every day, like everyday work for 12 hours to complete their evaluation. That's not fair. That's unfair also. So it's a balance. Okay. So when I'm thinking about, for example, I'm just talking about listening and speaking a little more because in the feedback where you are, in the kind of needs analysis questionnaire which you filled out, and the findings were shared with me, and I saw that more people have talked about how to assess listening and speaking. So we'll talk a little more about listening and speaking, but I'll also talk about self and peer assessment a little bit and other kinds. So when I'm thinking about listening for specific information, I'm thinking about the first thing I'm thinking about whether I should go for an audio clip or a video clip. You may have your reasons why you say that video clip is more authentic. Whenever they come across something like this, it may be a video situation where they see things. But video clip has its own demerits. Think one of these could be, when you get distracted by the visuals, you may not be able to pay attention. So for small children, video clips are not really encouraged when it comes to speaking, but it's very natural and it's authentic also at the same time. So you need to see what you need and where you can balance. And then I decide, it should be audio. For me, it works really well. I'm just giving you a hypothetical situation. Okay. It's a little, I'll go for audio clip. Then what? Then I'm thinking about whether I should go for a tailor-made clip or an authentic one. Tailor-made means I created the clip. I read out from a passage or something and I asked them to listen and find out specific information from that. But then I'm thinking, that doesn't work. I need something really authentic. So can I find something really authentic? Is it possible? Is it available to me? Do I know the sources? from where I can get authentic clips for my students, because I may be from Russia, let's say. I may not have somebody, or I'm from Philippines. Let's say I'm from Thailand. Let's say I'm from Korea. So I need somebody from my locality. Let's say I'm from Tamil Nadu. I need somebody, my students to be able to understand the accent of the speaker, because otherwise accent creates a problem. Okay, it poses a problem. How do I solve that? So I'm thinking about that. I'm thinking of something. It should not be exactly a Tamil accent as of English, maybe something slightly towards neutral. Then you question, maybe possible. So what kind will be appropriate? Maybe coffee with Karan? No, that's very vulgar, not appropriate for kids. Which one is for kids? So you search for those things and find out an interview from some source somewhere and then put it there. Okay, that works. Fine, that works. So I'm thinking authentic. I'm thinking how to get it from maybe Doordarshan. I get it from our national TV channel, Indian government's TV channel. I get it from there. It's fine. Then I'm thinking about the length. What about the length? How long should it be? Then I'm thinking 2 to 3 minutes is okay, because they are new students and they are in class 7 or 8. So they don't have much exposure to English. Then, rural school. So I'm thinking maybe 2 to 3 minutes would be good. Not more than that. Okay, 2 to 3 minutes. Then what? Then accent. Yeah, I'm thinking about accent. I have already talked about it. It will be Indian. Topic, maybe science and engineering. That's what they're interested in. I ask my students, what are you interested in? They say, yeah, we like something from science and engineering. Okay, we go with science and engineering. Then digital tools. This is the last concern. Okay, I'm thinking about where I can fit in these things and come up with an assessment. Then thinking about Google Forms will work really, really well. So how do we use Google Forms to do this? I'll show you one case. Okay, my digital setup is Google Forms. So I have these things I'm thinking about. Okay, I'm thinking about Google Forms, audio video clip, MCQs. Is this good? Or Google Form, audio video clip, and gap filling. Is this good? Which one? Or how many clips? If I have 30 students, do I take one clip or 10 clips? Should it be time bound? Should I ask them to submit 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or should I give them time as much as they want to take? And how many question sets? So all these things, if you take into account and then you come up with questions, then you will be able to find good combinations. So I will show you here how I did. I'll go back to chat if you have anything interesting to talk about. Just give me 1 second. I'm not able to reach the chat box.
Yes, Dr. Santosh, if you want me to read out with you.
Ajit, you can read out if you.
Yeah. I can see questions. I'm just checking them.
Okay. So shall I?
No, it's fine. I'm able to read it.
Okay.
Maybe it's a good idea to familiarize students with various accents, yes, but not in the beginning. You don't, you expose them to something they are familiar with in the beginning, and then, then add different accents. I think that would be a good idea. To begin with, if you, you start with something really strange, then that becomes really problematic for them. So maybe you begin with a Bengali accent for Bengali children to begin with, and then later move to a kind of, if there is something called a pan-Indian or something like that. I'm not very sure if that exists, but something like that for Indian students. So for regional accent is to begin with, regional accent is really good. Let's begin with that and then go and search for other, clips from in different other accents. Okay, fine, get it. So I'll just go back and show you one demonstration of how to create these things. Give me 1 second. Okay, so I will address how to reduce plagiarism. Let's go with this. I'll share the screen. Okay, here is my screen. So what I'm done is you can use this for listening and speaking both. Here I'm talking about something for, let's say, for speaking, okay, for example. And I want them to respond orally to my questions, okay? And this will give them a kind of difficult to plagiarize. You can stop plagiarizing when it comes to oral assessment. I'm talking about assessment of speaking skills by giving them questions where they have to talk about things related to their lives, their things which are personal in nature, which they have to reflect, they have to think about, like your place, describe your place, describe your home, or something like that. So they may not be able to really take it from somebody else and copy it as such. They have to do it on their own. You can say that they will be writing and do it. That's a possibility. I'm saying that you can minimize this. At least they are dependent on somebody who is close there and talking about their own place and all that. So that may help, but this is one way. So what I did here, I have to create a question paper. So I create a question here. In the question, you can see I use here something called mute. Okay. I'm going here. Reloading this page so that I have mute. Mute extension you can always add to any question you want, and it's available on Google platforms. Okay, MOTE. You can always use a question. You can create a question like the one I have done. So if you want to create a question, the M comes here, and you can click on this, and you can record the question. That can you talk about your home and your family members for 20 seconds. Done. So my question is created here. I'm deleting this part. Okay, my question is created here. And I want people to respond to this. So what I do, check here. See the question, send the question paper. Copy this, and you can you can respond to this question. If you install Mote on your computer, you can respond to this question. So I'm going to another page where I have Mote installed already. Browser. Okay, Mote is there for me. So when I play this, listen, and you can record the question. That, can you talk about your home and your family members for 20 seconds? Okay, so I'm talking about in 20 seconds, the student is required to talk about his family members and home. Okay, now the student can prepare, and then after this, you can click on mute. The student can click on mute. So my home, we are five people at home, my parents and my two brothers. I have, my father is a doctor, my mother is a homemaker, and my daughters. So something like this. So I just, and this is uploaded there. And I say that it's submit.
Hello, Dr. Santosh.
Yes.
One of the participants is requesting you to repeat the audio recording process.
Yeah. So the first thing, thanks for asking. Thank you for letting me know. So the first thing I'm talking about here is to install Mote, MOTE, on on Google, on Chrome or any extension, you will find it. It's there. Looking at exact, once again, there is anything. Yeah, it's Moat. Moat is a Google add-on. So you can use this as an extension on your Chrome or any other browser you have. And then after that, I will show you how to do this. Once you install this, I'll just repeat the same thing that I did earlier. I'll delete this question, recreate this. I've created a question here. I'll make it, because it's a short answer type, longer, anything will do, that is not an issue. So I'm just checking here. There is a moat, you will see this symbol here. So what I want you to do, you click on this, this will allow you to record. So you can always give an oral question here. And if you want to make it a quiz where you can evaluate it directly, you can do that in the setting. You can go to setting and you can make it a quiz and you can assign marks. That will be possible only when you make it a quiz, okay? If you don't make it a quiz, then it may not, you may not be able to assign marks to this. That will be the only issue, okay? Thank you, Cherry. Cherry has shared with everyone. You need to, once you install this, you just restart the browser, then it will appear on screen. If you have any trouble later, you do it. If you have any trouble, you can always get back to me. So then once you assign, make it a quiz, then marks will appear here. And then you click on record when you keep your this cursor on M symbol. Then you click on this. See that? Can you talk about your family in 15 seconds? That is my question. I have given them a question, okay? And want them to answer this question in and share with me. So what I do, I go to send. I click the link. Take this. Copy. Okay, I'll screen share once again, sorry. Then I go to another browser. Put that thing. Yay, I have the question here. You click on this, see that. Can you talk about your family in 15 seconds? That's it. That's my question. So how do I answer? In my family, there are five members, my parents and my two brothers. My father is a doctor and mother is a homemaker. Both of my brothers are doctors. Thank you. I'm done. So my response is there and I submit it. And then you can always grade it, because when you go there, the responses are here. So as a teacher, you can see this. Individual responses are there. I see the responses. You click on this. See that. Can you talk about your... Sorry. Where is my responses? One response I have received. Just give me 1 second. So once you get the response, you get this link and you click on the link and you play it and then you have it with you. It's as simple as that. Anybody can do it. And it's quite simple. Start using Moat is free. You can also use Moat on different other platforms like Google Docs and Google Docs, everywhere you can use. So start using Moat. It's quite good. And if you have students on whom you have to give oral feedback on writing and all, this is a pretty good platform. So use this, and we'll move on and go to the next presentation. Okay. Yeah, the same. This is what I was talking about. When we're talking about academic, we are thinking about speaking. We are thinking about the same pack, same way of looking at it, more or less the same thing. Okay, this doesn't change. When you are talking about speaking, writing, listening, reading, anything, you ask general or academic one, then ask the length, how the length of the text if you are using for, let's say, clips, audio clips, or for reading text, what kind of what is the length? The level of difficulty, where your students are in school, which level, which standard, what is the proficiency level, all those things determine the kind of thing or the text you decide to use for your assessment. Once with that, I'm talking about speaking, for example, I'm talking about academic speaking, I'm thinking about one way or discussion. One way means giving a presentation or talk about something, like a describing something. Discussion, participate in a discussion. Is it two-way or three-way discussion that you have to think about? That once you finalize how long it should continue, and are you giving them help in the beginning, or they should start and talk directly, no preparation time. So that will increase the difficulty level a lot if there is no preparation. If there is preparation, it will be challenging, but much less. So think about this. Think about assessment criteria, because we are thinking about, let's say I'm talking about presentations. I'm thinking about assessment criteria. What is it that I have in mind? Let's say I'm thinking about, for example, I'm thinking about content, organization, body language, maybe slides. These are the four things I'm thinking about in this. Okay, in the presentation. Let's say in a discussion, I'm thinking about content, organization, pronunciation, language. These are the things I'm thinking about. So think about the assessment criteria, what you have in mind, and then define it clearly. Talk about it very clearly. Describe it clearly. I'll show you a set of rubrics, which will give you an idea how it works. And then the digital part, which will be appropriate for my case. Because I'm asking them to respond to my question, I showed you one with Moat on Google Forms. You can do the same thing in a classroom situation with Flipgrid. Once again, you can go to YouTube and check how it works. It's quite simple. It's very simple. You create a group on Flipgrid and then create the question there, and then after respond to it, they take their mobile phone or computer or anything, and they respond to it, and then you can grade it. This is very easy. But the thing is that on Flipgrid, you cannot grade. On Google Form, you can grade. So you need to think about whether grading should be done on then and there, on that. You need to give voice feedback to that. Those are the considerations you have to make. In a voice thread situation, which is another tool, you can give comments then and there. You can use it for self and peer assessment. Well, in Google Forms, you can do that. In Flipgrid, you can do that. But you need to think about how you put them together, how you bring them together so that you get what you want. I will show you a few, but more. There are a lot more that you can explore on your own. Demonstration 2. Here I will go for a demonstration, other one I'll skip. The self and peer part. I was talking about the same thing. Okay. So here what I'm talking about is, self and peer assessment. I'm talking about, let's say I'm thinking about presentation skills. Let's focus on that. And self and peer assessment in relation to that. How do I do that? So once I'm ready, this is what they need to do. This is presentation skills is what I'm trying to in self and peer assessment of presentation skills. I begin with rubrics. First thing I need to find some a set of rubrics. Okay, people do that. I'll share my screen, entire screen. So something like that, this, okay? I have used this, so I'm just showing you this from my, this is for my master's students. So I used content, organization, slides, language, and body language. This is how I divide it, okay? You can divide it in the way you want. It's your choice, what you want to focus on. People add pronunciation, accent, and all that. I'm not really keen on pronunciation and all. As long as they are intelligible, I can understand them, that's I'm done. I don't need very specific kind of pronunciation, not really interesting. But you can, if you think you prioritize pronunciation and you have a reason for doing so, go ahead and do this. No objection to that. So here I have defined by content, I mean being focused on the chosen topic, adequately covering. This is what I mean by content. By organization means there should be a plan and the person follows the plan really well. So that means there is an introduction, body, and conclusion, and there's a coherence. There is some kind of coherence maintained across the presentation. Slides, appropriate background, font, font size, color, visual, everything is proper, good slides. Language, grammatically correct language, pronunciation is appropriate and takes appropriate pauses and things are okay, and uses appropriate linkers or transition markers. Body language, you are presentable, you look appropriate for the occasion, and your poses and poses are appropriate. Let's say. That's it. So you define this clearly and then give it to students. Show them this is what I mean. Take a presentation to the class, show them this is the presentation. Now use this and try to grade this. Okay. So what I did, is there a question for me?
No, Santos, please carry on.
Okay. So so I use this voice thread, one presentation I take to the class, ask them to look at the presentation and grade it using the rubrics which I shared earlier.
Hello everyone, yes, today is my topic is temperature. What is temperature? Temperature is a unit to measure the coldness of the body. The Fahrenheit and Celsius are the two famously used scales. So two questions are arise in our mind. If we know that 0 degrees Celsius is the freezing point of water, so what is the 0 degrees Fahrenheit? And who came up with the Celsius and Fahrenheit? So first we show Fahrenheit. Dutch inventor Daniel Fahrenheit. Dutch inventor Daniel Fahrenheit.
So then I asked them to comment on this. So Shivam Pratap has commented, looking nervous, need to improve body language. Somebody else commented, second half seems to be like a little fast, time management needs to improve. They're not really focusing. Then pronunciation, calcius instead of this. So they get off track when I didn't share the rubrics. But after I shared rubrics, they came back to the point because I focused on asking them to comment on only on things that are relevant to the what I have mentioned on the rubrics, not really everything that they want to talk about. Bring them back to rubrics. Teach them how to use it for self-assessment and peer assessment. It can be their own presentation, which is on VoiceThread, and they comment. You can look at the comment, give them a score, that is possible. Or you can put them together, 4 of them or 5 of them in a group, ask them to comment on each other's presentations using the rubrics. Take words from rubrics, take things from rubrics, and talk about in terms of content, organization, language, body language and slides, nothing more than that. So So you train students for carrying out self and peer assessment. They cannot do it on their own. My master's students could not do it on their own. They needed some kind of training. Okay. So you need to train them. This is the second part I'm talking about. Third part is to engage them in assessment. When you keep doing it for some time, then they get used to it and they do really well. They know what you expect them to do. But unless you do that, it becomes very, very problematic. I mean, it remains, you know, certain things are not really on track and all. You are worried. But once you keep doing it for a while, then they are on track. They know what to do. Once you are done with that, asking is to give them feedback and get some feedback about how you have done. So this takes a while, but start with WhatsApp, start with, voice thread. You can do any of these things. I mean, all these platforms are appropriate. I don't see any problem in any of these platforms. So check which platform suits you and then decide what you want to use. Okay. Then, so a few things which I have made clear till now, when we are talking about assessment, we are talking about skills guiding assessment. When you are talking about digital tools, we are talking about assessment methods guiding digital tools. If you go other way around, it becomes problematic. This is something that I'm emphasizing right now, and you must remember this. Do not get guided by digital tools. Get guided by your assessment. Let it take you to appropriate digital tools. Okay. Once you know these are my students, this is the skill I need to assess, this is the method I'm following, then think about the digital tools. You will find the appropriate ones. But if you say that this is a fancy tool, I want to use it, and then go back to your assessment, very problematic. Two things are always there. You have always, you can always negotiate, you can always be creative. These things are always there. But just think about these things very clearly. I will wait for Ajit. If there are any questions, I'll get back again to this. I have more. If you have questions, then I'll address a few questions and then.
Yes, Dr. Santosh, there are a few questions. Would you like to address them at the end?
Yeah, please. Go on.
Right now? Okay, then. So here are a few generic questions again. And Pragya Pani ma'am, Suman and Arti Dev asked the similar question, like, could you please share some open source tools to evaluate writing?
The thing that comes to my mind all the time that you can use is Google Docs. I mean, like I'm talking about, because writing is mostly subjective in nature, and we always use subjective questions. Writing is subjective, okay? And the assessment is more or less subjective. Even if you use rubrics, even if you use assessment criteria, and you go for rater training, still it remains subjective to an extent. But I'll show you how I have done it for my PhD student. Hope she excuses me for this. I will show you. Let's say this is the, I'll share my screen. You can ask them to share, their write-up on Google Docs. This is something that you can always do. Once they share on Google Docs, you can share with them the rubrics, the like I shared with you here. You can share rubrics on paragraph writing, essay writing, or the kind of writing you have done. Share rubrics with them, engage them in self and peer assessment like I showed you earlier. But what you can do when you ask them to self and peer assess here is the trick. You go here, click on suggesting. Okay. Now you have turned on suggesting. Right now, if I read this and there is a comma here required, or entire thing they read it, this part and I select this part, I feel that this is not really coherent. So they can comment, this is not really coherent. The organization is problematic. So the person can write a comment how to improve this. So you can ask your students to use comments on each other's writing, or you can also comment on this. Once it is here, you can always comment, reply, and you can comment on this. This you can do by sharing this with other students who are part of this class. And you can do it by asking the student to share with you, giving you editing access, and you can go to suggest, and you can do this. This is one way of doing it. You can give voice comments using Mote on this. This is again another possibility that you can explore. Mote is also useful when it comes to, you know, giving comments on this. This is also possible. So these are some of the ways you can do. I'm talking about, this is one of the open sources. Another could be if you go to VoiceThread. I'll go to VoiceThread. Just give me 1 second. Yes, absolutely. This is a wonderful suggestion from Amit KS. He's saying that write-ups uploaded can be also, you can give comments on WhatsApp and then marks. I have done that for a group of students. You can do that. This is amazing. And this Carlos Alvarez has also given a wonderful suggestion saying that students can collaboratively write on Google Docs, which is a wonderful idea. You can make them use something, a tool like Padlet, P-A-D-L-E-T, to gather ideas, to put ideas together, to put information together, and then work on Google Docs. That you can do that. Once they have the write-up, you can take a screenshot of the write-up and put it on, VoiceThread. You can ask them to comment on the write-up. You can do that. And you can also comment and assign marks. So you can do that with VoiceThread. VoiceThread is a very good one also. If you want to engage, there are different ones. I'm talking about where you have to give formal answer sheets and answers and give them scores. Then your option gets very limited. You have to get back to Google Docs as much as you can, Google Classroom, and to an extent to Google Docs, Google Forms. These are the more or less we don't have many other options as such apart from these. But I'm talking about when it comes to formative assessment in the classroom, you can use Nearpod, you can use Flipgrid, you can use, there are several which you can use. But I'm talking about Google Docs is really helpful, free, useful. So use Google Docs as much as you can. Add-ons can actually make Google Docs much more effective. So you can do that. If you have a paid subscription of something like Grammarly, that can be also be used for such purposes. You can directly create, let's say Grammarly or Turnitin. You can ask them to submit it to Turnitin. If you think that they're plagiarizing and writing, you can ask them to submit it to Turnitin. Tell them that there is reward for writing 100% original articles. So, or papers or, essays or paragraphs. So you can do that on Turnitin if you have a paid account. If you don't have, don't worry too much about it. It's okay. And Grammarly is also a wonderful way of developing writing. Grammarly teaches you where you can improve, how you can improve. I can show you that. But Grammarly, once again, is a paid software. Okay, it's a paid one, but Grammarly is very useful. If you want to buy something paid, go for Grammarly. It teaches you, but it needs some amount of training. If you don't know grammar, Grammarly doesn't work. That's again a kind of ironic thing. You need to have some amount of, you should be good. somehow your grammar is in place. You are doing well in grammar. I mean, you write grammatically correct sentences, speak grammatically correct English, then Grammarly is useful. Otherwise, it's problematic. Cheating in MCQ. Yeah, I'll just show you that. Give me 1 minute. How to avoid cheating in MCQs. Give me 1 second. I'll find one MCQ and then show you how to do this. I hope this works. Yeah, I have one. Dr. Veena Nair has asked, sure, how to reduce plagiarism and get this cheating. Okay, we have cheating and we have not been able to control it till now. One of the things that you can use is Mercer Metal. If you are in an institution which can pay for a software, you can use Mercer Metal, which is a proctoring software, which can help you monitor students' writing, what students are doing on screen all the time, and there is a camera capturing them too. So Mercer Metal is one good thing, but it's a paid one and you have to pay a lot of money for that. So it's up to you, but I'm talking about something for free you can do here. You can see the screen here. I have created a reading question here. Okay, as it's more to writing, but it's more of a pre-writing kind of question. Okay, so let me show you how you can minimize plagiarism. I mean, you know, minimize things here. What you can do is two things you can do here. One is you can click on this place, these dot places after you create this question. This question, there are four options. Then you can go here and create shuffle answer option order. Okay. This is something that you can do. One more thing you can do, go to settings. Go to presentations and then go shuffle question order. So that will change the order of the question. So what you can do is, let's say you shuffle the question order. So when I give this question to you, you will get this as the first question, this one as the first question. Somebody else may get this as the first question with this as the first option. Maybe you will get this as the first option in the third question. Somebody will get this as the first option in the first question. So this will happen. So that will reduce plagiarism, I mean, cheating to an extent. One more thing you can do is further, okay, which will reduce cheating a little more, is you can create sections, add a section. And then under each section, if you create questions, leave questions under each section, then they need to complete one section and then submit it and then go to the next section. You can do that. So you submit one section, go to the next question. You submit one question, then go to the next section. So you can do that. That will also minimize cheating to an extent. You can change in setting and that can do this. Okay. So that will to an extent reduce cheating. I hope that's helpful. I don't know if there are other.
Yeah, Dr. Santosh, thanks for sharing all these things with the participants. I was just wondering, can we create a question bank here?
You can create a question bank here. Yes, you can always create a question bank here. Whatever question, let's say you are you create the questions on these Google Forms, and then later you can always select questions from these and use them whenever you want. That is possible. So you don't have to use the entire package all the time. You can take a few questions and use, and then go back and take a few other questions and use. You can do that. But at the same time, if you have, let's say, 200 questions, and then you select 10 for these people, another 10 for those people, another 10 for those people, that facility is there only on Mercer Metal. That facility is not there on Google Forms as such. But I'll check if there is an extension available which enables this, that kind of thing, then I'll let you know. But I'm not aware till now. I don't think it's, till now, I have never seen that happening on Google Forms as such. But I'll check if there is a kind of extension which helps you in that, yeah, I'll get back to you. But Mercer Metal, yes, it does that. I'm just typing it.
Thank you.
You can ask the admin to buy you this thing. This is a paid thing. But Mercer Metal, I gave them 20 questions last time and they created 10 sets out of that. So, or 30, 40 questions, if you get them and ask them to create 10 sets, they can create 10 sets. And that's really, really useful because they won't have common answers, common questions anywhere. And the answers are shuffled, questions are shuffled, everything is shuffled. So it's really, really difficult to cheat on Mercer Metal on, MCQ questions. Pushpanjali is asking a question. How do assessment through online for small kids? Generally, if what kind of skills you have in mind, you should be able to tell me what kind of skills you have in mind, then I'll be able to tell you. Let's say if it's speaking, and if you have a small class, then you can directly have a conversation. If they are writing, you can ask them to sit in front of the camera and write and show you. If this is for small kids and you have a small class. If you have a large class, a lot of kids are there and parents also are interested in cheating and helping their students so that they get good grades, then you are in trouble, Pushpanjali. I mean, only God can help you. I can't. I mean, this is very difficult. If people want to cheat, they will end up cheating. I mean, you hope that people are ethical, they'll do a good job. But if you tell, let me know, I'll share my Facebook page. And there is a page which I can share with you. Now, there is a Facebook page. Just give me 1 second. Which you can visit and you can, there are around 4,800 members. I'm just showing you an old pic from this. You can, old screenshot of this, but you can have a new one. You can see that. Yeah, this is an old screenshot, but the same picture you will find. If you go and type on Facebook, ELTI India, you will find, I'm the admin of this. We have around 4,800 teachers there right now, close to 5,000 teachers. This is a quite useful platform. A lot of members share who are here, who are participating. I can see a lot of you here. They share a lot of good, very good posts there, which includes scholarships, information about webinars, international webinars by experts, talks and workshops, foreign trip scholarships, research writing options, I mean, where you can publish your articles and all, book chapters or call for book chapters and a lot more information. This is a vibrant place. We have plenty of school teachers, college teachers, university teachers, expert researchers from across the world. It's not only from India. Though it's called ELTI India, we have teachers from everywhere who are there. And this is the exact photograph you will find on Facebook. You can find me there. I'm the admin of that group. So I manage that group and you can join this and ask. If you find me there, you can put the question there. I'll be able to respond to you, your question. If you have any queries related to, you are in a situation, particular kind of assessment situation, you are assessing particular kind of skill, what you need to do. If you are not really sure, you can always share and we can discuss. We can come up with a solution. It won't be a problem. I'll always do that. I will never say that I don't have time, I'm busy. That's not going to happen. So do share. If you have an assessment situation, you can share. And don't worry about PPT. I share PPT with everybody. So I'll share this PPT with all of you and won't be a problem. I'll share with you on that. I'll just put it there, the link. You can download the PPT and use it if you want. I'll just check in India, especially countryside teachers and learners. Backward design technique of assessment can be replicated in assessment through digital tools. Possible backward, I guess back, by backward you mean go. You have the assessment ready and going back with assessment tools and seeing how it works. Or already you have something like this. Already people have used certain tools in certain situations and then see how much of it fits into your situation and then make adjustments and then use that. You can do that. That's really, really helpful. You can always do that. You can find how people do this. If you contact me, I will also share with you these things. my what I am doing in my situation, in my classroom, what I'm doing, I can share with you these things and won't be a problem. And I can share with you my assessments, rubrics. These things are there with me and I can share with you. You can always get back to me with these questions, the same kind of questions. Okay. And Joita Shah is asking, wash back, feedback. We don't use feedback. If you ask me about a lot of new research, we use the term feed forward. So if you want to use a new term and you are interested in using a new term, you can use feed forward rather than feedback. By feed forward, you mean you can talk to students and help them with what they can do in future, what they can do to improve their performance in future, rather than talking about what they have not been able to do in the past. So that works, but I'm talking about, you can talk about what they can do in future, and that's feed forward. And a lot of researchers right now use the term feed forward and quite in a very positive way. You can always use this. I have a nice quiz for you. Don't go away. This is the last thing. And then I'll leave it to the organizers. Just give me 1 second. I'll share the screen. Just give me 1 second. Here we go. We have a small quiz here. The code is 78310498. menti.com, same place. Share to one or two things you learned during this presentation. You can type one or two things, whatever you have and you think you have learned during this presentation. Important thing, when I'm talking about this, I'm also thinking about important thing is to make use of the tools you already know before learning new tools for assessment. Something you are comfortable with this, and then go back and use this. Okay, use something already you know. Make the best use of those tools before you learn a new tool. Okay, this should be something that you should think about. Okay, what we have learned: multiple assessment tools, MOAT, yes. Minimize cheating in MCQ, yes. Importance of tools in teaching and learning. VoiceThread, Mentimeter, and MOAT. Assessment literacy, digital literacy. Okay. Yeah, assessment. Good. So assessment should lead your digital tools. Digital tools should not ideally lead your assessment. That becomes problematic. This is a good learning. For me also, this is a kind of recent learning. I learned it in 2020. Don't have to lie to you. I should be honest. So, and this is true. And we have a good research. Good amount of research that suggests so. And if you go to the Google Scholar profile, my profile, I published a paper in 2020 in RELC journal. There I have mentioned this thing very clearly, that the teachers who participated in that study, they started with tools leading the assessment. Later, they moved to assessment leading the tools.
Dr. Santosh, when I was using the Mentimeter.com, after 2 to 3 questions, it is not allowing. So right. Is it so, or we have to purchase?
So what I'm doing is, I created these questions on, let's say, two. When you are creating quizzes, 5 quizzes are allowed and 2 opinion polls are allowed. So I, instead of buying from them, I create, for each presentation, I create 2 polls. So in a class, let's say I need 10 polls. So I create 5 presentations.
You're doing the smart work.
I'm saving money.
Okay, that's interesting.
So I didn't pay them any money, and I use this like this. If you have any trouble also later, you can ask me about this and I'll find more ways to inform you. Okay. How do you feel about digital assessment? Good and useful, informative, friendly, excited, excellent. Okay. Good. So you have good words to describe this. I'm happy. You can use Mentimeter. Mentimeter is a good tool for a classroom to make a classroom interactive. If some of you are already using Mentimeter, so for you it's not a new tool, but for a lot of people it's a new tool. They can go back and use if their students have access to computers or mobile phones. They can use this, and this is quite effective in engaging people. There are other tools, but this is very simple and easy to use. I have always, when I'm using technology, I have 2 things in mind. 1, it's helping me in helping my students in learning. 2, it's saving my time. I don't want to use technology where I have to invest so much time that I'm tired and upset about spending so much time. So I would not spend too much time on this. I would rather prefer to. Okay, Ajit. Yes. Any questions you can ask me, please. Ajit, you can go back to the questions and ask me.
I think we can invite some of the participants to share their views, opinions, or let them ask questions.
Yeah, you can do that. I have no issues.
Okay.
Yeah, if you can just raise your hands so that we can go one after another.
Ajit, can I?
Yes, please.
I'm Dr. Panda. Okay, thank you, Santosh, for a wonderful session. Okay, I've seen your session sometimes back in UAE, and that was the excellent session on academic, and this is good, but I have a small question. So I have a problem in taking online, or because we are going in a virtual mode of teaching learning method, so how best we can assess speaking skills online? Any tools for that?
Yeah, so some immediate tools for teaching, if you talk about teaching speaking skills. When you are teaching speaking, you can use speaking tasks which are there, which means with what kind of speaking you are teaching. Let's say you are teaching how to describe human beings or places and all. So there you teach them adjectives to begin with, and then ask them to give them a picture and ask them to go to, let's say, they can use a WhatsApp or a Flipgrid is a platform, I would say. So you can give them a picture, or you can give them on VoiceThread or Flipgrid, there is a picture. Ask them to describe that picture. You can do the same thing with a Google form with motivation. Put the picture there, ask them to describe it. They do that, then you can always look at it. But immediately in the classroom, Flipgrid is breakout rooms is rooms can be made made use of. You can send them to breakout rooms, ask them to discuss. If you want to teach them how to discuss things, how to learn conversation skills in English, you can use breakout. That is also a platform you can use. Zoom has, Google Meet has, and Teams has, everywhere you have breakout rooms. You can also use breakout rooms. It can be speaking for a minute. That can be done on a voice, on a WhatsApp group. If you have all your students on a WhatsApp platform or a WhatsApp group, you can ask them to speak for a minute about any topic they like, but you can choose a topic and ask them to speak on it. For example, examination, for example, teachers, for example, teaching, for example, government policy, for example. So you can take any topic and ask them to speak for a minute if you want them to, you know, start speaking without any fear. But speaking will not make them fluent in speaking, just speaking. So you need to also feed them. It's like asking somebody to go to gym and, you know, have a good body. That's not going to happen unless you are eating good food, healthy food and all, and then going to gym. So here you need to feed them a lot of things in terms of listening. So you need to give them a lot of things to listen to and then take them to speaking. I think then it will work really well. For example, teach, now ask them to listen to TED Talks. Flatmates, this is something that I can also write here. This is my favorite, all-time favorite. You type Flatmates, it's 1.5 minutes on BBC. It's there, you can download the entire series. Around 202 episodes are there, Flatmates. Take them and use them in your speaking classroom. These are amazing resources, free, and these are available. So you can use them, you can do that.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Santosh. We have so many questions. I don't think we can take all those questions. Probably, can we take a couple of them now?
Yeah, sure.
So Roja Rani, would you mind asking your question?
Let us make it open, Ajit. Yeah,
good evening, sir. Actually, I wanted to give my reflections on this. It's really useful, sir. Actually, we have been using these Google Forms. I'm a teacher, actually, in the government sector. We have been using these Google Forms and Flipgrid, Padlet. But sir, I learned a very new thing, that is add-on, that mode. It's really useful, sir. Now I would be using that. And one more thing I could say there, sir. Actually, we got boosted up by your session. Thanks a lot for all this, sir.
Thank you.
And one more thing I would like to add on, sir. As you said, we too learned from the during this pandemic session in season itself, that we have been engaged in the different webinars with people like you, and we learn many things from you people, sir. Thanks a lot for this. And I think many teachers are needed. Many teachers will be gained by such kind of sessions, sir. And one more thing, as just one of the participants was asking about the online sessions, online assessment tools, even we can use Quiz and Quizlets also now. So that means, I think they have also been very useful to us.
Absolutely, yes. They are excellent classroom assessment tools. When you are in a classroom and you are engaging students in learning assessment, those are really useful. But I also added Google Forms because a lot of us are in a situation where we are required to assess students formally, submit grades, assign them marks. That's why I showed you the Google Form part, because sometimes it's important to learn those things also, because you need to also.
The most important thing which I wanted to actually tell here is, actually every teacher, we go for assessment, but we don't care to give the rubrics to the students. Of course, we learned in different online courses, but I think as a teacher, I might not be doing the same with the students except the oral instructions. So I think the rubrics play an important role which should be shared with the children. Thanks a lot for this information, sir. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Yes. So Amit, you have raised your hand. Amit, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, good evening, sir, and good evening, one and all present here. I'd like to ask you one question, sir. Sir, actually, there are schools, there are universities, there are students, those who are from far-flung areas, and they are posting their answers, like written answers in the WhatsApp and all. Even I have a question, like, is there any tool to immediately just go through the WhatsApp images and just do the correction part, mark them there itself, so that the student can... Is there any tools for that, sir? So that the assessment could be made easy on the WhatsApp platform.
I did not see the same thing. So one thing you can do, and then asking them to take a picture of the answer script, what they can do, they can use Adobe Scan.
Yeah, they are doing it. Many of them, they do this, sir. I mean to say that when the students are posting their questions on the WhatsApp platform, is there any tool to just do the correction part in the WhatsApp platform?
Correction platform means you saying that See, there are two things you can do on WhatsApp. Either you can offer voice feedback or written feedback.
Right, right. Generally, they're doing that same thing.
Right. So if you have, if you think that they have done, they have submitted something and you think there is something. So ideally, if it's a continuous assessment process, then you can take one aspect of writing and take into that one aspect for week. For example, for this week, we'll be focusing only on organization, or focusing only on grammar, or I'll be only focusing on punctuation, something like that. So if I take like that, and then do the assessment accordingly for, I mean, I'm talking about a continuous or formative, it will work really well on WhatsApp. But there is no tool as such, which, because at WhatsApp, if you attach anything to WhatsApp, it becomes a security threat.
Right.
Easily problematic. But what you